Good. I'd like to start this presentation with acknowledging the work of the co-authors and pointing out that this is a joint effort between the University of Pavia, the Aalto University School of Engineering, and Technical University of Munich. This time I will talk about image-based evaluation of structures and not about simulation of the process, even though, of course, they're closely related to each other. And I will make the point that as designed is not always as built. Now, this is just a random sample of a search I did prior to this talk, getting numerous results, and I picked one that I found especially nice, and you can follow the report here in the reference. Now, of course, things are not always that catastrophic. I was looking for a special catastrophic case here, but they do differ, and we will look in this presentation especially at these kind of octet lattice structures, even though, as we heard before, they're not optimal. They're quite often used. These consist of a repetitive copy of such cells, and then you can print them like shown here. And when you look closely, then you realize that even in these sort of well-controlled processes as designed, is not always as built. So the question that was bothering us is, what is the effect of defect? Now, the defects I will refer to here are only geometrical defects, and I will not talk about the material and other complexities that are involved in this process. However, what you can do with these kind of products is, of course, you want to have a characteristic material property, and what you can do is you can produce a bunch of them, do statistical experimental testing, and then come up with a material characterization. An alternative way that is less expensive and likely faster is an image-based way. So you produce parts, you CT scan them, then you can do numerical testing without destroying the actual part, and from that come to a material characterization. What does such an image-based workflow deliver? What is it capable of? Well, it can deliver porosities, of course. It can deliver an estimate of stiffness, in tension, and bending. It can also deliver local stress states and also first insights into fatigue behavior of such structures. And you can check model assumptions for dimensionally reduced models. These picture-based analysis can also be a basic for stochastic characterization as well, we'll show later on. We'll talk about these 6 points in the sequel, and we'll start off with porosities. Now, porosities are easy to measure. This is an as-designed structure given a porosity of 0.75 roughly. And then when you print it, then you find there is a different porosity that you come up with. And the porosity here is slightly lower. And there's 2 ways to measure this. Either you do it with a CT scan or you submerge this structure in a liquid. And they agree fairly closely, but are far away from the as-designed porosity. Now, for all other properties, things will not be so simple. The point here is to show that there will be significant differences in those properties. And I'll make the point that a fully volumetric model is needed to gain insight into the effect these differences actually have. For this, we will use the finite cell method, which is currently commercialized in a company called DirectFEM. Now, why the finite cell method? The simple answer is because meshing for these structures is difficult. While they topologically consist of a repetitive application of these unit cells, they differ heavily in the details as shown on the right. And this makes it, you know, difficult to mesh. And if you have topological changes, definitely it's not automatable. So the finite cell method is an idea published in 2008. The aim of it is to do a accurate finite element analysis without meshing. So imagine you have this physical domain that you don't want to mesh, then you can extend it by a fictitious domain with a material of zero strength to achieve something like a bounding box, which contains the physical domain. And then you can easily mesh this bounding box by just applying a grid. These finite element, like finite cells, as we call them, then have a material interface. And this material interface is characterized by a stiffness jump from 1 to 0, where 1 is a value of a function that is 1 on the entire domain here, that is a physical original domain, and 0 on these non-zero, non-stiff fictitious parts. If you go to do finite cell analysis, like a finite element analysis almost, on CT scans, that things simplify because you have from the CT scans voxel data, and this voxel data looks like this. And then this discontinuous indicator function that I explained before, alpha, is directly given by the Hounsfield units that you get from the CT scans. So you get the geometry directly from the CT scans, and you don't need to mesh. The further advantages, since everything is so regular, you can apply pre-integration, a technique that is also often used in topology optimization. So you start with a CT scan, you make your grid that we call finite cells. And one finite cell can consist of, this is just a slice out of here, but one finite cell in here can contain more n by n voxels. Within these voxels, we have a constant Hounsfield unit and therefore a constant material property, which allows in the linear applications for a pre-integration of these sub-stiffnesses, which then can be assembled to one finite cell. The finite cell is the unit which spans the shape functions, much like in a finite element method. And then the assembly of these finite cell stiffness matrices make up the global stiffness matrix that can then be inverted to find the unknowns that you're solving for. I'd like to make the point that this is not voxel film, even though it might look like that to you, but it needs a lot less degrees of freedoms, and we can show that it delivers the same accuracy. With this method, it will be possible to analyze 3D structures in an automatized way directly from CT scans. Let's look into stiffness in tension of these octus lattice structures. And they were printed and experimentally tested in Pavia. Here is a experimental test with a deviation given about 12,000 megapascal. Then we scanned this octet truss structure, and we did a numerical test on it using the finite cell method that I just explained previously. Here, even though there is a lot of voxels summarized, we need about 98 million degrees of freedoms, but you get an answer in a fully automatized way in about 30 minutes. The values you obtain here with the CT scanned analysis are quite close with 13,000 to the experimental testing. However, when you do this on these geometrically exact cut models, you get about only half the stiffness. The same situation reflects in bending. We've done the bending tests, performed the bending tests as shown to the right. And I'd like to show you quickly the comparison of the bending rigidity here of the numerical values of the as-built structures here in green compared to the as-design structures here in red. Again, we chose that we get a consistently higher stiffness, about twice as high in the as-printed structures or as-built structures as in the as-designed structures. This is a dismal situation, really, because we were after optimization and not really, wasting material. We've been looking at homogenized properties, but also local stress states can be evaluated very accurately with this kind of a method. Here we have a picture of a gear housing used in a Hilti bore hammer. We can submerge this into the finite cells and, of course, achieve global quantities such like displacements or von Mises stresses here. However, what's of interest, look at this cutting plane here. If you cut this plane, then you see there's pores inside that structure. And of course, we are expecting an increase of local stresses close to these pores. This is depicted here. Now, notice how we use a very strong refinement, much similar than shown in the previous session. That refinement, that local refinement, goes way below the actual scale of the voxels, which is why you need a local surface reconstruction to obtain accurate results on these small scales. However, when you do that, then you can clearly see, this is a plot along the line I showed before from A to B and the von Mises stresses, how close to the hole when you apply this type of refinement, you get the expected stress concentrations. The ability to be able to compute local stresses accurately motivated us to try to gain first insights into fatigue analysis. I'll show you one result of this using the Crossland criteria. The Crossland criteria is a criteria used in high cycle fatigue and is based on the amplitude of the history of the deviatoric stress tensor. As a matter of fact, it's the second invariant of that deviatoric stress tensor. Also, you need to compute the maximum value of the hydrostatic stress that occurs in your loading cycle. These are values that you can obtain numerically by the finite cell method. And then you have the experimental side, that's the Crossland sensitivity factor that is experimentally obtained by the ratio between the fully reverse torsion limit and the bending limit. These are experimentally determined values. Here is the plot of this Crossland criteria in that structure. And you notice that the Crossland criteria has to be smaller than zero for yielding not to happen. So the scale here goes from blue to red, where it goes from about 200 down to zero. When it gets close to zero, then the yield capacity or fatigue capacity rather of the structure is used up. Minus then means it would fail. You find only a few gray areas here that of course depends on the loading that you apply. You can of course in a simulation obtain all kinds of large failures into fatigue. But the point here that we would like to show is that this fatigue criteria is non-uniformly distributed, not only inside here, the structure, but also along the beam. So this hints that is not good to use only a representative volume element and try to replicate this along a structure, because along the structure you have larger variations. This here is the bit plate, and this is the top of the structure. And you see that it's non-uniform. Now, for this insights, I think it's very important to do a three-dimensional finite element analysis. However, these computations are demanding, and that's why, of course, homogenized models make a lot of sense. So at some point, you don't want to compute in assemblies of such structures the full resolved structures, but you want to apply some kind of homogenization to come up with a cheap model for then what it actually is just a beam. Now, which theory should you use? There's a number of theories, and we were interested in the fact or in the question of course, which theory we should use, but also do those theories hold in these kind of inhomogeneous structures? The first bending, so we look at bending rigidities, and the first simple bending rigidity is the Euler-Bernoulli bending rigidity. I'm sure most of you remember this from the studies. It in essence has to do with the length, of course. Then you have the elastic modulus, the width of the beam, and the height to the power of 3. This is the rigidity that we normalize towards, and that's why we have a dashed line here at 1.0. The next complicated, or the, you know, if you expect shear deformations, you could use Timoshenko beam theory. In Timoshenko beam theory, you have a decreasing stiffness with respect to the Euler-Bernoulli theory when you increase the height of the structure. This is shown by this green dotted line, and the analytically computed Timoshenko beam theory here is the Euler-Bernoulli bending rigidity divided by 1 plus, and this is E divided by G, the shear modulus, times H squared over L. L is just the length of the beam. And when you go with H large, then you can see how this factor has an influence and diminishes the Euler-Bernoulli bending rigidity. But there is other theories that take into account microscopic effects, as we expect to see in these kind of structures. And these are strain gradient theories. The strain gradient theory counterpart to the Euler-Bernoulli classic theory is here given by the black solid line. And you can see how these theories suggest that when you decrease the height, the stiffness increases dramatically. This is because you have here the bending rigidity of the Euler-Bernoulli times 1 plus, and then this factor where h appears in the denominator. So for small h, you're going to get an increased stiffness. And then there is the counterpart for the Timoshenko one that looks similar, but has a softening effect also when the height is increased. So which model should you use when you try to model these kind of theories? You know, are the model assumptions valid? And we did a number of experiments. And I would say, judging from the experiments we did, they seem valid. So looks like these theories also hold for these kind of structures, even though these structures are not perfect. But surely there is more data necessary to validate these kind of theories on these additively manufactured structures. Ah, I forgot to put in over the overall scale here, but let's look at the stochastic characterization. So given all the possibilities of image-based analysis, we can then attempt to stochastically characterize these kind of structures because they have, of course, a large spread in the elastic modulus, which comes from also the geometric variations. So the classic way here is to produce many samples, to test and compute many samples, and then you record the results. Instead, what we wanted to do is to produce only one sample, then set up a stochastic model which can generate stochastically equivalent virtual samples. And then you could compute automatically with the finite cell method all these samples, record the result, and do some kind of a stochastic analysis that way. So here's the original sample, and that is a realization. I cannot go into the details of the model of the uncertainty quantification of the microstructural variability of these additively manufactured lattice structures. And I'd just like to show you some pictures here. This is an original sample, and you see then in one of these realizations, you can also replicate these holes. From these, you can compute the mean and the first moment, which is the standard deviation. And you see that the local variability, stochastic variability of the structure, of course, reflects also in the global homogenized properties. So what next? Here is one short video of what could come next. To the left, you see the von Mises stresses of a complicated additively manufactured structure. And to the right, you see the plastic multiplier, and it shows the development of the plastic fronts inside such complicated structures. Then you can do a nonlinear characterization of these structures and fit a global plasticity law given a local plasticity law. But hang on a second. That is a complete show movie, the one I showed you. Don't be tricked, it's not valid. The story is not quite so easy because there is still a lot of to-dos. We need a robust way to obtain the geometry from a CT scan. This is non-trivial. I couldn't talk about this too much in detail. We need somehow a relationship of the Hounsfield unit giving us an elastic modulus. What kind of plasticity model is actually correct? We have had no microstructure variation in there. That, of course, depends on the process and the cooling rates. Fracture is definitely something that we would need to look at. Fatigue surely depends on the surface roughness, grain formation, pre-stresses, which depend on the process and so on. And what about the robustness of the solver? You need the solvers that can handle 10 billion degrees of freedoms in nonlinear computations on these complicated structures. And we're not as robust as we would like to be in these kind of simulations. So let me give you some conclusions. The good news is that image-based analysis is definitely a divine tool for estimating the effect of defect. So you could use that in quality control and build also stochastic models, as I demonstrated, to come up, for example, with safety factors that will definitely have to be computed for you to use these structures in critical applications. And all of the above is valid for the linear regime, but nothing of the above may be valid for the nonlinear regime. So the good news is there is a lot of work to be done, especially in validation, other material, mechanical quantities, fatigue, plasticity, and so on. And well, the summary is really the difference.
Evan, of Erst designed. You need to come to the end.
The difference of Erst designed to Erst built parts is significant. And I think to understand, quantify, and qualify the differences of Erst built and Erst designed structures is fundamental. Thank you for listening. And that will conclude my talk.
Okay, thanks a lot. So the talk is open for discussion. So Mark.
Yeah, thank you very much. So thank you very much, Stefan, for the nice lecture. So my question actually related to these stochastic realizations. Did you just assume Gaussian distributions to build them, or did you in any way connect that with the real statistics of the printing process itself? Because strictly speaking, there should be a relation. So what exactly did you do?
So the stochastic model is based on a real valued Gaussian random field with zero mean square and unit variance. And you use, this is this Gaussian random field, and you use a threshold function, for example, depicted here, to come up with a model that can then replicate one of these cells, and you copy these cells around. These local thresholds, they're defined through local probabilities, and then you have to correlate spatially the binary random field. And for that, you assume separability and have an underlying Matern correlation model that would then be able to give these give these kind of unit cell, I would say, stochastic structures. Global variations, as for example, global bending, is not in that stochastic model.
Okay, so it was really based on the images, so not the process conditions itself.
No, but the just image. On the images.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
Feng Wing, next question.
Yes, actually, thanks for the nice talk. I have a question related to your remodeling of your CT scans. I'm wondering what for the CT, for the image, you need, which software do you use?
It's all in-house software.
Okay, so how could you treat your CT scan image into the into your own software?
Oh, we can just load it in. You have to, maybe there was a joint work with Grön between our group and your group, and to exploit the advantages of this method also in the topology optimization field. And it has been found in that work that it's about 10 times more efficient than doing VoxelFem. And you can load this in from CT scans directly.
Okay. Thanks. Do you have a paper on that?
Yes, actually, we have a joint paper. I'm not co-author of this paper, but I think Rank and Ole Siegmund are, and I can definitely forward you.
Thank you.
Adrian, next question, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Stefan, for the presentation. My question is regarding the differences in the stiffness that you measured essentially from the CT scan structure and the CAD structure. I wonder if you have some insights on the primary, the first order causes for that difference. For instance, is the porosity, like scaling the thickness of all the struts in the CAD a remedy, for instance? It'd be nice to perhaps understand a little bit more.
Yeah, short answer. You see, this is a view from the top to the bottom. This is the build direction. Here you see it fairly uniformly. This is viewing the other way. And the other way means you would look underneath the structure. Here's the build plate and you look upward and you see that here you have a lot of underhangs. So most of the problems come from the underhangs that are produced by, I would say, unstable melt pools in that thing.
But how does that lead to an increased stiffness? I mean,
have more material in there, and then you accumulate more material, and these struts are actually thicker than they are planned to be.
So then my question is if you took the CAD and you just thickened each strut, would you like to match the porosity?
It's not uniform, and material also accumulates along this direction. I'll show you a quick, it looks that way. So you would have to do, coming from an exact CAD model, that's what you would have to do to achieve this.
Okay, thank you. I'm not trying to solve the problem. I'm just asking you, because I haven't solved the problem, right? I have thought about this problem. So you think that it's the inhomogeneities that are giving you the difference in stiffness?
So all we've been looking at is the geometric variations. When you say inhomogeneity, then I would say yes, if you mean in geometrically, if you mean inhomogeneities in the materials, we did not.
No, that's what I mean, geometric. Well, thank you.